Good morning. We welcome you to church today. Today is the day that we celebrate Pentecost. It's one of the big, actually, three holidays. It ranks up there with Christmas and Easter, but I think it's in the spring and people are off doing other things. I know some people are dressed, have red on, so congratulations. I don't know whether it was a coincidence or you planned it. So what was it, those who have read? Coincidence or you planned it? What'd you say? Planned it. What about you, Ro? Planned it. Ray? Coincidence. You know what they say, a broken clock is right twice a day, right? So we're glad that you're here, and for those who are watching online, we welcome you also. So spend a few moments looking at our announcements. Reminder that, as I said, this is Pentecost. There's a trustee church council meeting combined following the worship. The trustee meeting will happen first, so if you're just a trustee, and you can leave if you want to after the trustee meeting. This coming Wednesday, there is a post-general conference webinar, and I'm going to be in the conference room setting it up. I sent most people an email. You can also set it up and watch it on your own, but you have to pre-register to that. And here is our regular schedule. I'm giving this out ahead of time. I'm going to be starting this new Bible study called Faith Working Through Love on June 20th. It's a great study. I'll be sending another email out too, but it just asks a lot of questions about theology and how to understand things. Like, for example, there's one that says, what is Pentecost? Or what is the witness of the Spirit? Does God love animals too? And it gives it based upon John Wesley's sermons and the Bible on the other side. So I'm going to try to stream that to Facebook. So we've been dealing with some technology updates and so forth. So that will be June 20th. The reason I'm giving it to you ahead of time, there is an optional book. If you want to order it, why did we just lose everything? Did you just hit something, Kathy? Oh, there's no screen? I guess we'll just do the best we can. People worship God long before we had screens and all this kind of stuff. So when we get to the music, you can always turn to the hymnal. Okay, so it's on there too. So I don't know if the bulb's burning out or what the case is. So I talked about that. The next thing I wanted to mention was the summer cleanup. We set a date for June 22nd, that's a Saturday from 9 to 2. We'll probably have some donuts and stuff there, so show up. Maybe the trustees can come up, you can come up with like a project list, and you know, so people know what needs done. So we looked at all the dates and everything, and the scouts will be involved in this also. So just wanted to, that's like kind of like a save the date thing. Okay, any other announcements? Now I'm going to keep turning all the time, keep seeing if that screen's still there. Are there any other announcements today? If there are no other announcements, we can begin with worship by our opening prayer. Hopefully it'll stay there. If not, I'll just read it. We do have bulletins, but we usually don't print a lot of them because they end up just being thrown away. So let's pray together. Holy God, Spirit of love, come from the four corners and renew us. Chase away our doubts and light a fire in our words and deeds. Holy God, fire and dove, come to your church, inflame our compassion, enlarge our witness, and stretch our hospitality. Holy God, breath of joy, renew our worship, touch our hearts, bring us peace. Let's join in our call to worship. On this day of Pentecost, as we worship, may God pour out his Holy Spirit upon us. May the power and promise of that day long ago renew us and our church on this Pentecost day. In our worship, may our hearts be set afire with enthusiasm, and may our lives glow with energy and courage as we live the good news of new life. So our first song is Spirit Song. If it goes out, you can turn to page 347 in your hymnals. It would be there. Hopefully that was just a glitch and it'll stay on. I don't know. Okay, let's see if our, who do we have here today, if we got some of your lollipops. Did you guys get a lollipop today? There you go, buddy. Okay, here we got Patrick. All right. Who do we have? Carson and Charlie. There you go. All right. Let us worship God today with the presentation of our tithes and our offerings. Gracious and ever-loving God, we know that you are the breath of life and that you love us, Lord, and come upon us like flames, Lord, and help us to live together, Lord. So as we celebrate this coming of your Spirit at Pentecost, we pray that your Spirit may be with us. And Lord, as we gather together this day, we present ourselves, our tithes and our offerings to you so that we can be co-builders of your kingdom until you come as you promised that you would send the Holy Spirit then one day that you would return yourself. We pray all these things in Jesus' ever-powerful and strong name. Amen. So you may be seated as we continue in a time of prayer, and you may lift up any praises or prayer requests that you would like to share today.
I've been asking prayers for a fella. I work with his mom. His name's Vince. He's not doing well at all, but he's going to have surgery on Tuesday at Jefferson Hospital. His name's Vince. So if you could keep his family in prayer. Thank you.
Okay, we're asking prayers for Vince having surgery on Tuesday, correct?
Yes.
Thank you, Carol.
Asking
Grace.
For continued prayers for Jack.
Continue prayers for Jack, and we're definitely have prayers for him. And Jack's dealing with Parkinson's, and we want to lift him and Grace up in prayers. Darn.
Yes, I would just like to tell you folks that we are still accepting cards for Reverend Hartley, and there is a basket out here in the narthex. His birthday, his 95th birthday, is June 28th. And they're living in Sarasota, Florida. And we will be mailing the cards in a bulk mailing probably around June 20th. So you still have a few Sundays to bring them in. Just bring them in and put them in the basket.
Okay, thank you, Dar. Are there any other?
There are also some cards out there if you wanted to use them as well.
Are there any other prayers? Yes.
Like prayers for Paul's cousin, John. He's in a coma right now, and it's just a matter of time. He's in hospice, and it's just, we need prayers for him and his family. His wife is not doing well.
Prayers for John and his family. Thank you.
Thank you. And continue prayers for Paul. And hopefully he will find a medication to help him sleep.
Thank you. Good to see you both here today and last week, too. So it's good to see you back. Ron.
I'd like to pray for Rose's family, her uncle Gene and her uncle Herman. Her uncle Herman's going to have triple bypass in a couple weeks, and her uncle Gene's doing the best he can right now.
Okay. Uncle Evan bypass surgery. Rose's uncle, we'll keep that and that family in our prayers. Karen, please.
I have a praise. Bill's celebrating a milestone birthday tomorrow.
Oh, wow. Aren't you going to tell us what it is?
It's 80, but everybody would know that already.
Oh, 80.
If you live around here, you know.
I thought it might be 30. Any others today? Let us go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, we come to you again, and we give you praise and thanks for everything that you have done in our lives, Lord. We give you a praise for those who have, whether they be joys, Lord, or various surgeries that are being faced, recovery, dealing with chronic disease, whatever things we face, Lord, we know that often life is hard. But the promise is that you are always with us. So we especially on this day count on you being with us as Jesus kept his promise to the church when he gave us the Holy Spirit. Lord, let us always rely on the Spirit to guide us in all things. We pray this in Jesus' name and remember the prayer that he taught to his disciples that we lift up this day as our prayer, and that is the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you. Before I read the scripture today, as we mentioned, we know that this is Pentecost. I'm sure that we've experienced Pentecost many times in the church. But what I'd like to share is I'd like to go back into the Old Testament and give you some context of the Jewish, Israelite, and now Christian, these holidays that some of them you may recognize, some maybe not so much, and how Pentecost, you know, fits into all of that. So you go back into the seven feasts that point to Christ. The number one, and the first two happened while the Israelites were being held captive in Egypt, right? And the first one, I'm sure that we're familiar with, is Passover, right? That's where the blood of the Lamb was shed. And as Christians, we understand that Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. He takes on that role of Passover, which the Jewish people still celebrate today. The second feast also takes place in, while the Israelites were in Egypt, is the Feast of the Unleavened Bread. Remember that they had to flee quickly, so they did not put leaven in the bread. So the bread did not what? It did not rise. So that is the second Jewish feast, is the unleavened bread. And as Christians, we see that as when Christ was crucified, he was put into the grave, but he did not rise until the third day. So that connects to the unrisen Christ in that time. The third feast that we find, and all this, by the way, all these feast holidays can be found in Leviticus chapter 23. The third one is the first fruits. We're always to give the best to God, to give our first fruits. It also represents that after the winter, the first seeds that were planted for the early, quick, smaller harvest was barley. So they would celebrate that first harvest in the spring. It was called the festival or the feast of first fruits. And this corresponds in the Christian calendar to Easter, because Christ was the first to be resurrected, and then many of us will follow in his stead. So this is where we get to Pentecost. Pentecost is also represents 50 days. The time from Easter until Pentecost is 50 days. The ascension of Jesus into heaven was 10 days ago on the 40th day. But we know that Pentecost is also a harvest festival. It's the second harvest after barley, and it was a wheat harvest. And so it was called the Feast of Weeks because it was weeks after the first barley harvest. And the harvest corresponded with how many, 7 weeks or what, how many days? 50, less the word penta. You hear the word that, which means 50. So then I just wanted to round this out to give you the context. So that's the fourth feast in the Old Testament. The other one is the Feast of Trumpets that happens in the fall. This is what the Jewish people today still celebrate. It would be the new year, which would be Rosh Hashanah. And then you have the Day of Atonement is the sixth feast, and that is what the Jewish people today celebrate as Yom Kippur, right? And then the last one is actually a fall feast or celebration. It was the Feast of Tabernacles or Booths. When the Israelites came out of Egypt, they had temporary shelters before they got into the Promised Land. They lived in like booths or tents or whatever you want to call it. And so that feast is a reminder of when they were lost and sort of like wandering around the wilderness. So all these feasts, as you see, some of them very much are very active today in both the Christian and Jewish faith. So Pentecost is actually the second harvest that takes place after the Israelites are in the Promised Land. I know I gave you a lot of information in a very quick manner, but that's the backstory to Pentecost. And the reason why it is the second harvest that is bigger is because you'll see in the reading that 3,000 people were saved in response to Peter's sermon that he gave after the Holy Spirit came. So let's go ahead and we're going to look at this scripture today. So when the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly, a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. Now there were staying in Jerusalem God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven. When they heard this sound, a crowd came together in bewilderment because each one heard their own language being spoken. Utterly amazed, they asked, "Aren't all these who are speaking Galileans? Then how is it that each of us hears them in our native language?" Amazed and perplexed, they asked one another, "What does this mean?" Some, however, made fun of them and said, "They have had too much wine." Then Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice, and addressed the crowd, "Fellow Jews and all of you who live in Jerusalem, let me explain this to you. Listen carefully to what I say. These people are not drunk, as you suppose. It's only 9 in the morning. No, this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. In the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions. Your old men will dream dreams. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they will prophesy. I will show wonders in the heavens above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and billows of smoke. The sun will be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the great and glorious day of the Lord. And everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Fellow Israelites, listen to this. Jesus of Nazareth was a man accredited by God to you by miracles, wonders, and signs, which God did among you through him. As you yourselves know, this man was handed over to you by God's deliberate plan and foreknowledge. And you, with the help of wicked men, put him to death by nailing him to the cross. But God raised him from the dead, freeing him from the agony of death because it was impossible for death to keep its hold on him. This is the word of God for we who are the people of God. Gracious God, as we come to the time of message, I pray that the words of my mouth, the meditations of all of our hearts would be acceptable in your sight. So wind power is one of the most promising forms of renewable energy compared to natural gas or oil products, coal or nuclear power. It's less dangerous, less pollution, all that kind of stuff. But there is downsides to wind power, and one of it is that the best winds don't move at ground level. Anyone who has flown a kite or sailed a boat knows this, and this is why energy windmills on land, where are they built? They're built on mountain ridges, right? I lived in Somerset County for 10 years, and all the ridges, if you've ever been up there, have the windmills on them to catch the energy of the wind. So the higher you are off the ground, the more powerful the wind. So the key to taking advantage of wind energy is being in the right position. Winds are at their strongest 6 miles off the ground. At that height of the jet stream, at that level, the winds are stronger and they blow more consistently, carrying up to 100 times more energy. So as a general rule, the higher you are, the more wind that you're going to get. And it's going to max out when you get to the jet stream that has 100 times the wind power of the wind on, you know, right at close to ground level. But how can humans harness that incredible power and energy? Conventional turbines on tires aren't able to get near close enough. The tallest to date is about 200 meters high. And we'll probably not be able to get turbines ever 6 miles in the air, but the more height there is, the more power there is. So actually this has been addressed. I haven't heard of it or seen of it in the United States. But to address this issue, there was a German company that developed a fly-in generator that looks like a cross between a kite and a helicopter. It is shaped like the letter H with rotors on the four points and is tethered to the ground by strong cables. So I looked into this to see if it actually exists, and I learned that it exists off the west coast of Africa, in northern Africa, in this country called Mauritania that was built by Germans. And so there, you can actually see these. They have these wind turbines that are tethered to cables that are pretty high in the air, as high as they can get it. Probably not near 6 miles, but they're a lot higher than anything that we have here. So those who are in the business of harnessing this tremendous power of wind that swirls constantly around this incredible blue planet that God has allowed us to live upon have learned an important and a really a vital truth. If you want to catch the wind, you have to put yourself where the wind is blowing. Sounds like a lot of common sense, right? If you want to harness wind, if you're flying a kite or you're sailing a boat, you have to get your sails or get your kite or get your windmills, whatever it is, you have to get it where there is actually wind. So call this the Pentecost paradigm, because the same principle applies to the church. If believers in Jesus are going to tap the limitless energy of the Holy Spirit wind power, then we are going to have to position ourselves correctly. Now, the wind is always blowing whether we're catching it or not. If we want to catch the Spirit, the power of God, it's always there. It's all about positioning. So I talked about this H-shaped flying generator with four rotors on each point of the H that is positioned in the air as high as possible to take full advantage of the power of the wind. So in similar ways, in Acts chapter 2, there are four points to put into place that I see that the full power of God can be harnessed and put into use in the lives of believers. So the first one that I want to talk about is the community point. Acts tells us that on the day of Pentecost, the apostles of Jesus, where were they in verse 1? I know I can't scroll back, you won't see it. But where were they? They were all together in one place, right? They were all together in one place. And that tells us, where were they? They were exactly where they were supposed to be. Were they all together? Yes. Were they all there? Yes. Were they all in one place? Yes. So the apostles of Jesus, they were in one house. They were complete in number, all together, gathered as a community. They were not in different places, but they were in the same spot, on the same page, reading from the same song sheet. And the togetherness is crucially important. The apostles were told to wait together for the power of the Holy Spirit to come upon them. So the Holy Spirit, in the verses 2 and 3, it tells us, the Holy Spirit came like a violent wind from heaven and filled the whole house where the apostles were sitting together. The apostles saw what seemed to be like tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on them. To me, that indicates like a connectedness. So what if the apostles had been all over the place? There would not have been a catching of the wind of the Holy Spirit because they would have been out of position. I don't know if you ever watch, I'm sure we have at one point, whether currently or at some point in your life, you ever watch little kids play a sport? What's the number one thing they do? They get out of position, right? They're playing t-ball and the ball's hit. Unless they're trained and they start to practice and learn, their inclination is to do what? To run where? Towards the ball, all of them, right? I don't care whether it's kickball, football, they don't stay in position, whatever sport it is. And so that's a key to success, isn't it? Everybody has to stay in their own lane. If you get out of your lane, then it's not going to be successful. It's just like you never see wind turbines. They're not in the valley, right? We don't have any wind. They're all on top of mountains because that's where the wind is. So Pentecost was a communal experience, and it was only because they were together that all of them were filled with the Holy Spirit, and they began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. Other experiences of the Holy Spirit are often spoken off of as individualistic, right? Like terms that the Holy Spirit spoke to me. But at Pentecost, it wasn't God speaking to one of the apostles, but the Holy Spirit came upon all the apostles because they were together in one place. Now, the second part of this four parts of this wind turbine that I want to talk about that would be crucial to look at this paradigm would be communication. Acts tells us that all the apostles were gifted by the Holy Spirit to speak in other tongues. Because even though they were all Jews, they were coming from different places, and they did not speak Hebrew. They did not speak the same language. They spoke the language of wherever they were. So Pentecost was a harvest, as I mentioned, was a harvest celebration. So Jews from all over the known world came to the temple in Jerusalem to worship and give thanks to God. And because they came from all these different nations, they were speaking the language of where they lived, even though they were Jews. So they arrived in Jerusalem for this harvest festival called Pentecost. That they were really there to celebrate Pentecost, which was a Jewish holiday, right? It was celebrating the wheat harvest, the larger harvest of the two harvests, after the spring harvest. And so these 12 apostles from Galilee begin to speak to these out-of-town visitors in their native tongue, and this kind of freaked them out. Like, could you imagine, like, you go somewhere, and you know this person, like, shouldn't know your language, and all of a sudden they start talking to you in it? I've seen videos of someone who is, like, just looks like a young white American. They'll go to, like, a Chinese establishment, and they will start talking in Mandarin. And you should see, like, the looks. They're just, like, totally, what, in shock, because they're not expecting this white guy to be speaking in the native Chinese language. And what's kind of funny, they really get embarrassed if they were talking about some of their customers, right? You don't know. You go to a Chinese or Mexican, unless you know that language, you don't know what they're saying about you, right? So they were, like, it's so funny because they're, like, totally caught off guard. They weren't expecting, like, this white guy to be speaking in native Chinese language. So when someone does that, what is the result of that? It catches your attention, right? It grabs your attention real quick. So what do you think the apostles are communicating? They're not just saying, you know, how's the weather? Did the Pirates win last night? You know, probably not. But they're telling these foreign worshipers about Jesus Christ. They're telling, that's what Peter's message that comes up in this chapter. So the apostles are gifted in a way so that they can effectively communicate the gospel of Jesus Christ to unbelievers. So doesn't the Holy Spirit want us today to use different languages to communicate the gospel of Christ? And I'm not just talking about actual languages. I'm talking about positioning ourselves where unbelievers where they are, and communicating in their language. Isn't this what the apostles did, and the Holy Spirit enabled them to be able to catch people? Talk about how they were in Jerusalem during Pentecost, and they didn't have to go anywhere because all the people were coming to them. Like, they're all coming back to celebrate Pentecost as a harvest festival. And so they were in the right place. You know, sometimes, you know, we have to be in the right place. Years ago, the church started this place called Hot Metal Bridge Church down on the south side. I don't know if any of you remember that. I don't even know if I haven't heard about it recently, but the intent was to meet people where they are, right? And that was what Keith Coffin was trying to do, you know, with 8th Avenue Place. But I think since they've moved into one of the churches down there. But that's the whole idea of that, right? To try to meet people where they're at, because some of the people who are going to go to 8th Avenue Place or to Hot Metal Bridge Church, they're not going to go to, like, a regular church, right? So you're trying to meet them where they are. So at Pentecost, the message was the same, but the message was put in a language so people who couldn't hear it before now can hear it. So the fourth point, so I talked about communication, and before that, we were talking about some other things, but what I want to talk about now, community, communication. So the third area I wanted to talk about is courage, the courage point. Acts tells us that on the day of Pentecost, as the apostles were enabled by the Holy Spirit to effectively and amazingly communicate the gospel of Christ, the critics and the slanderers stepped forward to make their remarks. If you looked at verse 12 and 13 that we read today, it says, some were amazed and perplexed, and they asked one another, what does this mean? Some, however, it says, made fun of the apostles and said, well, they're probably drunk because they had too much wine. And Peter says, no, we didn't. It's only 9 o'clock in the morning. So he was saying that that's not the reason, right? So they were under attack. They were criticized. So when you're under attack or criticized, what do you need? You need courage, right? You need to have courage. So Peter, with great courage, steps to the plate and says, you know, we're not drunk, as you suppose in your minds. He says, no, these men have the power of God's Spirit poured out on them, and this was prophesied by God's word and God's prophet. So the Holy Spirit challenges us to do the same. Especially when people dismiss our practice of faith, our job is to show a little courage as we describe what we see God is doing in the world. Like when people criticize what the church, you know, we have to call, I mean, I hear all the time, well, the church doesn't pay taxes. Actually, we do. Like we pay employment taxes. The only thing you don't pay taxes on is your tithing income. But everything else we pay taxes on. But people don't understand, like churches, they engage and help people in foreign mission fields. Like I shared a couple weeks ago about Guatemala, about what the missionaries are doing there, literally saving people, not only their spiritual lives, but also their physical lives, like feeding children who literally are malnourished and are in danger of dying. Like here we feed the homeless. Like we have the scouts are part of the church that do lots of tremendous good stuff for, you know, young men and women now, right? So what we do, we should be able to defend, no, this, because we're going to be criticized, but we need to be able to say the good things that we do. So when people disparage the work of the church and what God is doing, we don't have to be engaged in arguments, right? We just need to be a lot like Peter and point out all the good God does in our churches, community, nation, and the world, and faithfully proclaim the faith that we have in Christ, not just with words, but also with our deeds. Do you know what Peter did? He said, what you're seeing here, this miracle, he said, this is a God moment. This is God at work in the world. And Jesus said, do not hide your light. Put it on a stand, so that the world may see your good deeds and as a result praise your Father in heaven. So the last point I want to make on this paradigm I'm talking about, I talked about community and communication and also about courage. The last thing that we see at Pentecost, bless you, is clarity. When Peter spoke to this crowd, he didn't come up with anything new. Instead, he clarified a passage from Joel that had been confusing before, but now made perfect sense. So he brings this whole passage from Joel, but no one could understand exactly what it really meant. So what Peter does, he brings clarity from this Old Testament prophet. Before Pentecost, it might have been difficult to understand what Joel chapter 2 was talking about. But Peter said, do you see what's happening here? Today at Pentecost, this is what the prophet Joel was saying would happen. And after Jesus went back into heaven, he would, and the Father would, pour out his Spirit on all people. And all who would truly call on the name of the Lord would be saved. And Peter told the crowd the gospel message, and 3,000 people were saved and baptized on that day. So this is how it ties into the Jewish feast days. You see that the first spring harvest is equal to Easter, because who was resurrected first? It was just Jesus, right? So he represents the early, smaller spring harvest. But then weeks later, this is why Pentecost is called the Feast of Weeks, we have how many coming to Christ? 3,000 people in one day. So the early harvest, being just Jesus, was equal to the barley harvest, and the Pentecost harvest, which was the wheat harvest, is equal to the first 3,000 people inaugurated into the church. So Peter, he clarified to unbelievers what God's word was really saying. In Acts chapter 8, this is six chapters down from what we looked at today, you have this beautiful story of this Ethiopian eunuch, and this is going to bring the gospel into Africa. There's this high official, and he was a high official in the government, and he's sitting in his chariot, and he's reading the Bible, and he's actually reading from the prophet Isaiah, but he has no idea what it is saying. It doesn't make no sense to him at all. So the Holy Spirit spoke to Philip, one of the disciples, and told him to go near the chariot and wait, right? So again, that gets back to that positioning thing, right? Putting yourself in the right position. So he goes to the chariot and waits. And then this eunuch, this high government official, invites Philip up into the chariot to explain God's word to him. Again, what's it about? It's all about positioning. 1 Peter 3:15, I believe these words apply to us today. Always be prepared to give an answer to anyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have. That's just not for pastors. Someone comes up to you and says, you got to be positioned for this. Well, I don't get this religion thing, or whatever they want to call it. A lot of people just use the word religion, faith, Jesus thing, church thing, fill in the blank. And they say to you, well, what's this all about? I just don't get it. Why do you go to church? Why do you believe in Jesus? What does that mean? Well, if we're going to follow what the Word of God says, we're told to be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have. So that's your homework assignment. If you don't have, or you cannot give an answer, you need to be able to be prepared to give an answer. Maybe I should have a follow-up sermon, make it all about you, and just say, what answer have you come up with? What is your answer when someone asks you? So will we use it with, position ourselves with community, communication, courage, and clarity. To make disciples for Jesus Christ, to save souls, these 12 apostles, they positioned themselves in the full blast of the Holy Spirit, and they used the full power of God that was available to them. And here's the thing, folks. We might have saw this past weekend, right, how powerful wind is with what we have, like 5 tornadoes touched down. The thing about wind, and that's what this passage is equating God's power with, it's constantly renewable, right? It's not like coal or oil, like you burn it and it goes away and eventually it's going to run out. Or nuclear, you have to break, atoms, right, to get nuclear power plants working. Or gas is just another carbon, just like oil. But wind is sort of amazing. It's power that is always here. We cannot get rid of wind if you even try. Like right now, if not right here, somewhere on this great planet that God gave to us, wind is blowing at massive power, right? I don't know, maybe it's in Antarctica, I don't know. But there's massive wind everywhere all the time, up in the jet stream. And that wind has tremendous power. And I think it's fascinating how the Word of God connects that power to the work of God. It's something that can't be burned up. It can't be go away. It's always going to be there. And the question for us as the church and as individuals, are we able to position ourselves where the power of God is? Let's pray. Well, at least I see, how long has that been up there? I caught you. Oh, the heads were bowed and just 2 minutes. Okay. I don't know. Let's pray. Gracious God, things happen in life just like today. For some reason, this screen decides to act up, but that doesn't stop you, Lord. We just push through everything because we have your power and your wind at our back. And Lord, what's amazing about what you teach is we don't have to like pedal on a bike, or something using our own power. It's like your power is behind us. It's just up to us to tap into it and use it in our lives. Lord, I pray that each of us, and we as a church, tap into this tremendous power that you've given to us, that Jesus promised when he left after he ascended back into heaven. He says, I am going to send to you the promised Holy Spirit. Lord, help us to live and rely on the power of God's Spirit. We pray this in the name of our great Christ Jesus. Amen. Okay, I guess we're off again. So that's, we're going to Spirit of the Living God, page 393. Let us go forth in the name of God our Father, go forth in the name of Jesus Christ, and especially today, let us go forth in the power of God's Holy Spirit. May God bless you and keep you this week. Amen.